I just came off of a class, a 3-hour class with our students, and we were discussing some of the developments of the last 7 weeks, which have in fact marked the beginning of the transformations that we will never be able to escape, none of you, no matter how young you are, for most of your lifetimes. Dire transformations in the world that will mark virtually every move that you make, and which will impose themselves in a way on a daily basis. Of course, the problems of migration, not only the political and religious migrations that have been set into motion now, and which are already completely overrun the capacity of the world to manage them and administrate them. But of course, the great transformations, as the French journalists say, you have the French frontière, the attacks in Paris, and the transformation, if you like, of the essential attitudes toward geopolitics and security. These are the changes that will have, they've already been set into motion. They will mark every aspect of everyday life, virtually everywhere in the world. And finally, of course, climate change that was not averted by the agreements in Paris. It was merely a symbolic sort of gesture of acknowledgement. No major disaster has been averted by them. And by the end of the class, it was so depressing, I didn't know where to go. And I just reminded myself that Thomas is coming to join us today. And I said, Thomas is the kind of guy who walks into the room laughing. There he is, he's laughing again. And he'll walk out of the room laughing. And what we would learn from him, of course, is that this problem, the various problems, in this case perhaps climate change, is something that the designers has to engage with laughter and with joy and with affirmation and with invention. It is not a time, if you like, to hang our heads. It's a time to reinvent fun.
I think so, yeah, I don't need to explain what Anthropocene is, so...
No, you don't.
No. It's a game. the board, that somehow maybe together we could kind of try to discuss it, what it means to live in an age which still there are not even traces of it, or how we could somehow start to shape it, since we have maybe the capability to trace the Anthropocene, what it might be, and people who maybe we don't want to leave traces but still remain. I mean, I thought like very quickly just to go through, and some of you might have saw, but to refresh a little bit, go through a little bit, couple of works, as also I think Mike in the beginning, some for a of you would always interrupt, and try to go on with this conversation. One of the things which I just a very quick thought is like, because less than 50 days I'm back here, this is the latest circus on earth, is Bolivia, is Ujumi, is quite high, is a place where the stars are seen amazingly. And it's the biggest example of lithium also. We talk about solar panel batteries and energy and flow. It's a place which where you might have some good impact with stuff. And I think so it's that very quick digging down to the ground. But one of the things which I want to say a little bit to put up the context of it is that the horizon most of the time can blur. You don't see it. Anyone can switch off a little bit more the light than possible. See anything better with somebody. But it's something, I mean, this idea of the horizon being completely blurred is something which has been kind of obsessing me during the last 10 years, maybe, because this has been done, I think so, 10 years ago, or this, 9 or 8. You see, what I'm doing, what we are going up there is to do a video during the night. And what is quite amazing most of the time is that in this place, all the stars also get reflected down on the ground. It's through the rainy season, it's that about December, January, February. And as I said, it's the flattest surface now. It's all the surface of this is 250 kilometers in the widest dimension, is covered with water. And so you have to imagine during the night when you walk down there and you see the stars absolutely reflected down on the ground. Step on the water, there's a ripple effect of walk on the stand. There is this kind of cosmological connection, I think, so, or some kind of immersive or where we might be. At that time, they didn't have the camera really to be able to trace the stars. And also, I think so, I don't know if we were talking about sensory perception, I think so, two or three generations before ours, I think so, we were able to see one third of one star that we can see today with our naked eye. I mean, somehow, due to light pollution or sensitivity, or because maybe stars stop to be guidance for ships, or because maybe we don't look anymore up so much, our eye cannot see many stars that we could have seen a few generations before, because I think so, Professor Band also is in the room. Discuss a lot about spiders and sensor and books and umwelt and environments and I think so. I talk also a lot about this today. This means this idea of being maybe well, this some couple of other images we have where there are a couple of clouds. And I thought maybe you might know this image today. This man, you don't know if he's looking at a telescope or he's ready to be himself to be shook through a cannon. See, the telescope somehow became a kind of, what is that? So it's this story, you know, that they're trying to look down in the earth and there is life in another planet. And they look through a telescope and they say, well, it's not life out there. The next year they bring a telescope and it'll be bigger. You see, it's like the inches or the centimeters of this telescope keep growing. The next year we are here on earth, right? And then we build a telescope which is quite a little bit bigger. Look again, well, there's nobody out there. The telescope keep getting bigger and bigger and bigger. There is one moment that the size of the telescope is so big that the others see first the telescope that we think is called telescopes here, or other form of life or science. This means this idea of always having maybe some kind of that you try to see something, but you don't even know, or you never know at the end how you will be contact with and discover through. And it's been in this sense, you know, art for me, integration with architecture also has been a kind of a medium which maybe how Francisco Varela also talked also about this dialogue of reality, how it's been the ability to maintain this dialogue to that extent. This means I think I'm trying to go a little bit quicker. Forgot about the lithium. This means the compass do not work. I hope so this time with the GPS, yes, we work. This means the north, when you are here, because the Hindu is so loaded that the north all the time keep changing. And a couple of million years anyway on Earth, so the north will be somewhere else. It's something that, again, this place also has been one of the places also that have to be used to calibrate telescope in space. This is so flat, we used also a couple of reference. This means, you know, if you go back also, you know, in relation to the Lambda, this kind of dispute, and I think this is also in the text of Sanford, that we need to draw a little bit back into historicity of flags and kites and ionic instruments in the Chinese history. This meaning, you know, this is one of the history of before the Brandenburg was here. 2,000 years ago, there was a civilization, pre-colonial civilization, which somehow managed to draw these lines, these drawings, which are observable only from a high elevated point of view. Now, Maria Reich, a German scientist who worked for 25 years and studied this drawing, there are some lines which are over 20 kilometers straight, which even with a great cosmology knowledge that they had at that time, they could not figure it out through the trigonometric system how they could draw these straight lines. And this has been in 73 or 76, I think so, Julian Knott had asked National Geographic to build a tetrahedron balloon, as you can see here, made of the intestine of the cows. And with this method, they validated the idea that these were the first civilization who put a man into the air to make a drawing that they were not able to see. And I love this kind of forgotten technology to be able to see if maybe this, because it's about traces, no? We talk about the Anthropocene, Eocene, and where the traces, it might be invisible by who to that extent. This is, I think, so this project I will quit. Well, I've been working a lot with interspecific communication between different species. In this case, I'm trying to compose maybe some sound or some relationship or reverberation among different spiders. In this case, there is a lower one, there's a Nephila from Madagascar, a solitary spider usually, and the upper level there is a Psittophora, which is a semi-social spider. And we try all the time to see if somehow they have some kind of, they use the web as a kind of a medium of communication species, or at least, or maybe sometimes they let's say we are trying to do a kind of an orchestra. We have a kind of this arachno orchestra, which is just opening in Singapore, and there are different... I will not draw so much attention about the cosmic web, which nevertheless has something to do with the beginning of the talk, when we have been busy, we'll be kind of a jam. But something, if you want to interrupt always... Yeah, the practice, what we have now, more than 35 people in the studio, we work a lot with anthropologists and different of science. Well, I was quite surprised now in Nature Physics magazine, which my family comes from scientists, finding a PF4 patent, the latest project, which I never thought I would get such a prominent journal. Nevertheless, I'm very interested on this kind of you know, collaboration or work that we do together with mostly lately with arachnologists. We have been quite concentrated. This means we have been scanning for quite some time. I think you mentioned a spider web. We have to do something with the origin of the universe, and there are some geometrical nodes and lines and points in space which we are trying to understand how things are interconnected. Just go back to this idea of flow, how matter and flow, and how from now, from one node is connected to another node, how things come.
I have a thought. I can't yet figure out how to make a question out of it, but let me begin. I find it fascinating that you were looking at the idea of an orchestra when you brought two different species of spider together in a single space. And there is a field, a science field, that is quite small and obscure, but it is known as acoustic ecology. And it was born largely of the 1980s, I believe, when they began doing field acoustic recording. Republicans, and they, especially under by this guy named Bernie Krause. And one of the things that his analysis discovered, he was, I think that's right, he was trying to determine, in the case of doing some logging in a major forest in California or somewhere on the West Coast, the logging company said, we will not disturb the ecology and we will restore it when we're done. And what he did is he created these field recordings before the logging, and took pictures, of course. After the logging, once they restored it, took recordings again, and essentially demonstrated that there was a total transformation in the environment that could not be restored, would not be restored, because, in fact, there was only one-third the number of species in the environment. Now, further study showed that the animals partitioned the acoustic spectrum in terms of both frequency and in the time of day they occupy it, because the acoustics is such an integral part of their territory. And that's to say that each species must find a niche that is acoustic as well as through the network of their biology. So this discovery, of course, tells us that space is an entirely different type of thing, even in biology, where we're used to measuring it than we thought. Just throw this away, and as you deal with this, if you have some comments or ideas about that.
No, and you put it away. One of the things which I'm trying to avoid, one of the books that kind of inspired me is Brian Massumi, when he talked about what we can learn from animal politics. This is a quite recent book. And what I explain also, you know, sometimes when we work with analogies, when we do all these kind of different type of, David Bowie is by the name, but Peter Yeager, one of the person who we collaborated, is another nephew, one of Manu is by the. But anyway, one of the things which I'm quite interested in trying to sense is a little bit back at one of the spinal dogs. Usually there's always this kind of female, male kind of dance. Everybody knows the bees. But one of the things which was somehow missing also to try to understand if there are gay spiders, lesbian spiders, or they are a different type of playfulness, relationship among the classic thing, male, female. Well, I think so, or at least through the web, is something which has not been studied so much. What I'm trying to sometimes going through is about, let's not too quickly underestimate maybe this idea of with whom we want to communicate and how we do this ritual in this dance. This is one of the things which we are all trying now to observe is like, let's say, well, I know that the more kind of effective and the one we know is like, for example, just to give you an idea, the sitophore in this case, where the males come to the side, there are two orb webs, but not really orb webs, this is more like a three dimensional spider web, but where the male want to mate with the female, which is in the middle, and that's what I'm trying to avoid, is he comes on the side and starts to produce a very rhythmic, at least for our understanding, movement on the web for over an hour. You have to imagine the effort that he does. He loses 60% of his body weight just to seduce, to kind of pluck this, the right strings until the female get excited and the one of the things also now we are working, it really kind of exploding crazy. And one thing that I have to say, what is my entry point in all this work? Because now the Max Planck Institute is giving us some funds, we are opening up the lab together, I'm working together with MIT, with the engineers department, with the Senckenberg Museum, with Professor Bach, we hope so we will move on the acoustic part. There is a lot of university institutions somehow which are teaming up and we are working. The niche that also Sampo is saying, and I think it's important also us, and I would say I'm not somebody who can give you, but I found out that there is no connection of spider webs in the entire world. I mean, the best thing they could have been doing is this terrarium, which sometimes always is difficult of, and Professor Bartley, if I may mistake, might correct me, but it's kind of reproducing this nature in kind of an environment, but that that extent also was very difficult to study the web as such as we are able on this kind of hybrid environment, which also, you know, put a little bit in crisis this idea of, you know, in the age of the Anthropocene, what is nature or not for the spider? Because every time that people come and see some of these cubes, they say, well, when do we go back to nature? I say, well, nature is the core of that building, because the spider usually they live, used to live also, it's an architectural building. You see, it's also a little bit like a stress out this relationship. This is a bit, well, to try this analogy between the cosmic web, right, which is this millennium simulation type by the Max Planck Institute, and the three-dimensional spider web is the guy who wrote the book LinkedIn, which is a Harvard also. We are trying now, since we have this kind of three-dimensional data of all these nodes in space, we can now drive more comparison between these two models. This is, well, at the end, yes, it came up all these scientific papers, and in the world of the laboratories also, you know, I kind of love to keep this dialogue with these scientists.
Let me help you get a bridge to move on. In the example of the spiders, in a particular space that they generate, because it's true, they generate their own space, in fact. I suppose it's a recent discovery that a considerable amount of it is determined by the need to produce and to receive vibrations. That's to say, in some ways, to extract from the void, or to impose into the void, the capacity to carry, sustain, transmit, ultimately possibly even store vibrations. The void, of course, is the fact that it's made up. Now, I argued, of course, a few years ago when we did an exhibition at Harvard University called Divine Comedy. At the time, of course, I'd say this work was so widely seen, or perhaps in a way, before people had some clear ideas of what exactly it was, I remember arguing that it was primarily, that people think of it as science fiction, but it's primarily social.
There is something which I'm obsessed now a little bit about is ballooning method, which is how the spider also migrate and when, how they move from one colony to another. And usually what they do, they just go up from a, you know, top of a tree, a branch of a tree, they really look from, and not all spiders make webs, and not all spiders make ballooning, and there are all sorts of different types of you know, when we did this orchestra, we divided kind of a little bit, kind of a human relationship of understanding. But you know, we have spider women, they're very good in drumming. The substrate that they use usually are leaves. There are some other spider which we kind of simulated more about like chords or strings, and this middle of the playing kind of guitars or harps, which were their own webs. And there's the other instrument which was more based on of trying to think about this aeolic. What the wind or how the airflow it might produce also some sort of sound, or how we can sense this airflow and the circulation of air to the planet, and how spiders also are able to travel and migrate through this. I mean, going back to the idea of the sociability, usually spiders, the way how they do, they go up to the tree, they release the threads. When the wind is good enough, usually, well, for our perception, you could say, since they have very different organs, and the one who usually build the webs, usually they're very poor in eyeing, it means they're kind of blind. The one who do not build the web, they're very good in sightseeing, and it's kind of gross relationship.
So the web serves their eyes.
Something that is. And also the web, how much is the extension of their own body, right? To pick up, you right, it's like the tympanum that we hear, the airflow heating up, and people get, you know, it's kind of, I kind of like to think that the web is kind of extended deep, but more three-dimensional space. But nevertheless, when these spiders want to fly and travel, there are something which is called a social panoply, which is kind of, it's not so common and still have not been very well observed. Does it mean what happens usually the spider go up, this effect, when the thread is long enough and the wind blows, when who knows the direction, because they're blind also and they don't know where to be landing, but they are able to cross thousands of kilometers. And does it mean, but anyway, the pool is long enough, at least they can fly quite small distances. Now there is this piece of spider which is the Cerovifus from Namibia.
Why do they?
Well, I think so because usually when they're young, the spider babies, and then, you know, just go and colonize some other place. Usually the baby spiders. But in the case of the Cerovifus as such, the female is already mature and also big. They want to fly. Why? I don't know.
Like, no, why there's a beautiful thing. There's an aesthetic bucket. There's an economic reason. And that is to distribute resources. Right? So, yeah. And then there's the aesthetic
I think so. Adrian Clare also my long collaborator, but when you work in Nicaragua also there is a student, a PhD, who also working with Yael Noble, and what he does, going back to the energy, he measured the weight of the spider before they built the web and after they built the web. So then he kind of tried to sense the energy efficiency in relationship with the distance, you know, but there was always speculation. Something like this. This mean, but you know, when we go back to energy, when we said that I'm draw some kind of relationship with, you know, when Fuller thought, and also I was speculating on the area of spaceship Earth, what is the energy efficiency of the planet Earth traveling 140,000 kilometers around the sun every day? Why? I mean, is it efficient, the speed that we are all flying? And I mean, that's the same question of efficiency that, you know, many of these spider might get into a certain jet stream or not. This means it's always, you know, I hope so we will get there quickly, but what I mean is how we can maybe sense also these, or how we can get on board maybe of this spaceship Earth, for example. Balloon spider. There is this very huge spider which is too heavy. If she will use only one thread, she will not be able to fly because the thread needs to be 7 kilometers, quite long, and it will break. Even if the spider silk is one of the strongest material on Earth, and we will be able to reproduce it, then we might be able to build a space elevator. This is one of the. It will help us to go out from this escape velocity. Go out from the planet to be more efficient.
Yeah,
but
you're going on about the spider.
Okay, the spider, what it does, what they do, she goes up to the tree, then she goes, another friend goes up to the tree, and all together they start to release these threads. Now, these threads are the normal silk, a little bit of glue, normal silk, glue, normal silk, glue. Now, the wind will come, there are all these threads blowing, the wind in that direction, and the wind somehow start to weave. Kind of a magic Aladdin carpet, or kind of a fabric. Remember, each fabric is one single thread. One single thread will not take the spider on board, but if they all release the strength to the mercy of the wind, blind left, as they, we might think, then this carpet is weaved with these thermodynamic wheels, with this flow of energy. We somehow weave this carpet. Now, when this carpet is weaved, it's like kind of a parachute, you have much more drag. And you mean they all send this track and they all release it by means they can fly quite some distances. You mean I like this idea and going, and this was a little bit the answer of Sanford, this idea of the social and how the social also somehow in my in this case allow them to take this some of these.
Those are real pictures.
Yeah. This means, I will go quickly, this means I love this kind of choreographic dance or might be traces of the Anthropocene or traces of the Aerocene. This ability to maybe sense energy in a different way on the way of how to we travel to that extent. And then I've been like, trying to think of what is a sculpture somehow which might be able to sense this flow of energy in a different way and how we can kind of keep this kind of sense of exploration, mobility, and curiosity with some of the things. Well, I will not really get into the thing. Well, these are some images of the Grand Pandé. Maybe I'll show you a quick video. Forward in time. So somehow, you know, I tried to see how we would be able to put it up. This is, yes, you know, also when you think about this is what else we have been doing. We have played two records recently in the White Sand, which is a very highly military space, militarized space. It's a place where might be the first places also in Anthropocene, where they exploded the first atomic bomb. This is in New Mexico, Texas. We make a war record of a human flight for over 3 hours. 8 pilots have been aboard without burning any fossil fuel, without battery, without helium, without hydrogen. This means, you know, we are now trying to make a free flight. This was a tether flight. There have been other people before, but not for so long. Not
losing the burden. Just if you don't mind, I'm telling you a boring technical question. That looks like a pretty carefully high-tech manufactured balloon. What is the principle upon which it works? Is it the black fabric that absorbs? Can you explain to us why that thing?
Because it seems quite complicated, but you know, I mean, when some people have been seeing an exhibition at House 21, but you can build diorcine out of this. I mean, in this case, we have been picking up plastic bags, which somehow is also might be another traces of the Anthropocene today on Earth. This is the same image. And I mean, what we do also, you know, maybe a social community work, we take them together, we build these kind of huge canvases, the sun come up from the horizon, and this, the pieces became airborne. This means, you know, a highly technical material could be something which also had no cost, because we are cleaning up the planet out of material which maybe too soon we trash, and we downcycle instead of upcycle. This means, you know, it's a little bit also this idea of speculation. This means, well, the one white sand has to lift up the person in this case was lifting 200 kilos, just a bit of black fabric, there is nothing. And this means also when I'm in the middle of the Grand Palais, I say, hey, I can make no one look around the world, because in the 1882, they made 3 times around the world. And I talk to an engineer who have been developing this, which is a little bit more sophisticated, and we can keep this culture up for 3 years. This means in 22 days you make around the world, learning the flow of the jet streams. And if I ask you how fast you go in the jet stream, you flow inside the jet stream. Somebody of you know the average of the speed inside the flow of a jet stream, how fast you can get. Our air pollution is 180, 300 kilometers per hour. Free highways constantly moving from one side of the earth to the other side of the earth. This means what we believe now with MIT, which we got a grant also, and we are trying to bring back this technology. I show you the kind of a provocation also we need for the climate conference. This means the question was, what about the old politician coming to the COP21 United Nations climate conference might come with an aerosol vehicle? And this means they are taking off from Boston, and this means I will kind of draw the flight path of Obama and different people who might be coming to Paris. This means these are different flows. If you look on Boston, you see these colors. Some of them get in a kind of a turbulence, they get out of Cuba. This is like every day we launch one of these sculptures, they get up into the jet stream, and we try to hit the target, which was Paris. Now you see the relationship with the, well, it's kind of reverse, backward, this is some of the traces, during the day, during the night, and how you can reach fuel-free Paris, and let's say, and also the way how these pieces get up into the air, without battery or solar panels. Well, this has been a different speculation. In this case also, you know, I pick up all the existing data with the French space that I have been working in the past. This project is outdated, I give it to them, and now we start to draw this kind of simulation of future. And let's put it into architectural scale, cloud cities. Let's not forget also the ambitions of now also. We might be living in the future of these airflows, as I think so. This is me, yeah, with the material. I mean, what we do then later, we know the political action is quite, you know, this was, I'm working also quite a lot with the Red Cross at the moment. We are, you know, kind of trying to redistribute the re-sensing what this culture can do. Also, this is Unico with other artists in the Peruvian rainforest, and what they are trying to do, and we work with Public Lab also. It's all about knowledge production and distribution to that extent. They have a lot of oil spills in the rivers, fishes die, and we don't find a passive out of it. They build back this sculpture, which is also polyethylene, a byproduct of oil, and then they build up gathering cameras and controls and kind of try to make proofs again. Multinationals, which also struggle to, you know, Google Earth does not upload satellite image on these areas when there's not so much interest in the population. Does it mean what we do? We sign petition, it's a Nobel Prize. Yes.
Who is it?
I forgot the name.
Okay, no worries.
He was the guy who wrote the first PP interplanetary, and then they won the Nobel Prize on climate change. What we are trying to do is over time now to change the law of the air. Here we are flying from Berlin to Poland, 500 kilometers, some other things. We're taking off. There's some more images of the latest piece. Yeah, it was so strong that to poop. I mean, if you think how many people have flown this type of, let's say, I would call it culture and technology, but only 12 or 15 people in history of humanity. This is something which is so simple, but at the same time, nobody maybe had the time to wait for the sun to rise at this scale. When we are above the level of the cloud, above the weather, we can be aloft day and night, because we pick up this infrared radiation, right? As the video we have been seeing before. No? It's this kind of thermal bands, no? During the day, 38 kilometers, during the night, we drop down, and we pick up the warmth of the Earth. This means the Earth is the battery. And this is something which I love about these sound for text. It's about how you can sense this energy. You know what, when you go outside in winter, you touch the asphalt that is still warm, you know, and you feel this temperature. Well, the sculpture pick up this temperature. This means the Earth, you can sense the temperature of the Earth. In fact, this temperature, the sculpture, it doesn't drop down.
There is, if I could just, I interrupt you, I want to, first of all, small question is, who's hanging from?
The first four were all women. Here's the man.
You said the women up first, women and children go up first. Okay. My question is this, is there, you know, just it's an association, there is a very famous story, one of the most famous stories in the last 200 years of science, is the idea of what they call Maxwell's demon. Maxwell's demon was a mythical character who would create work for free. And the way that would happen would be you would just select warm, let's say, molecules or fast molecules and separate them out from cold ones. And he would allow the cool ones to pass from one chamber warm to another. And this would cool part of the universe and heat up another part of the universe, which flagrantly, is the right word here, but basically flies in the face of, negates the second law of thermodynamics, which we know you can't escape, and yet Maxwell's demon does so. It seems that your heresy, or your, it works in many ways like that, locally, that's to say, when the sun is out, it's a vehicle for capturing the differential from the sun. When the sun is gone, it'll suck the energy that remains stored like a battery on the Earth. I think the concept of a battery may be maybe the biggest idea there is, actually, for the future, these natural batteries.
Exactly, because we go now to Bolivia again, but it's the biggest resource of lithium, which we think that that's the biggest battery we can power on the future. But you know, getting that more kind of this cosmic signal, this energy flow among stars, you know. That is beautiful also, there is the text of also Boris Groys also, which is the poster, so it's coming up also. When he writes this piece about the politics of the sun, you know, and he tried to analyze also, going back to the question about social structure. He always studied a solar maximum. You know, every 6 years, the sun had kind of much more power, much more sun to the Earth. And this is what he studied through a Russian physicist, and he analyzed, you know, every kind of time there is a revolution on, there is a solar maximum, there is a revolution on the Earth. It's always conceived. And over time, the revolution is from the left and non-conservative. I mean, you can expect in the next 4 years that it will be again a solar maximum and will happen something on Earth. Just to draw kind of a parallel between a kind of a social, political system in relationship with this exo energy or generosity of the sun, which maybe is too much, which somehow draw back also of the text that you are in the book, you are writing with Kilmore and all this kind of, we don't know yet what we could invent about it. How many terabytes we can see today from Earth, put it on these scales.
Right, yeah, okay. A basic idea, you respond to this. Michel Serres, a fairly well-known philosopher and historian of science in France, still alive, argued that his project, for those of you who know it regardless, the point is this, it came from a long line of sailors. And the question he asked of the history of science was, what would the history of knowledge and the history of science look like if it was written from the point of view of the nautical creature? That's to say, if it was written from the point of view of the sea, or from the life lived on the sea, which of course, the whole physics of the sea is radically different from the physics of land. And I feel there was also, okay, later on, as an offshoot of the Gaia hypothesis, there was a concept of hypersea. Every time I ask if you know something weird and esoteric, you always say, yes, I know it, I've been there already. But the hypersea idea is that all creatures who live on land essentially are part of a larger strategy of the sea itself, of seawater, of saline sea, finding a way to produce sealed bags of itself that can perambulate and survive on land under certain conditions. Of course, means you always have to constantly replenish your supply of water and maintain the homeostasis of the salinity inside of the biological body, etc. But the idea here is that there is a broader set of strategies by which the creatures of the sea, who are in fact sea themselves, actually come and live on land. Now, your project, one would argue, is an equal biological, political project of migrating into the gas environment.
Well, because going back to the scene, I thought there's this beautiful sentence, we tend to think of ourselves as living on the surface of the planet, but we also live on the bottom of the ocean of air. I like this idea, and how unexplored is this territory. We always have fast food rockets. This means there is a quite an amount of species being able to live up there at the moment. This is one of the things also that we are trying to do when these species will be traveling. It will be, again, trying to see first who is up there. I think there are 25 million animals or insects and bacteria at any given time over a square mile kilometer above the Earth, which is quite enough, 25 million. And also when you think about how this low energy wind that is thermodynamic, they found a plankton on the solar panels of the International Space Station, 400 kilometers above us. You see how they help this flow, you might be able to bring a plankton down from the ocean up to the ISS, which usually, air currents might not be able, space that 100 kilometers, which is quite difficult to move up there.
What are you showing us here?
Well, this has been also, going back to architecture, everybody might have known Fraiotto, what he did with a Lightwave Institute, and maybe some of the interesting things also are part of this research also might be able to use by others, but many of the things we have been working here is based on a program which was called EASY. An EASY program was developed also at that time from the generation of Fraiotto due to this collaboration. And we are picking up part of this research, bringing back RMIT. And this means thanks to this that we can very fairly study and try to minimize the weight of this installation and try to make it as transparent as possible. And this kind of net somehow also has never been used for this purpose. a lot of the things of the study who come from the spiders, this energy efficiency, the material, the connection, and then later is brought to the program then together with all these sort of things, and this is one of the things where we kind of using part of this, this thing. While checking love, yeah, I don't know where.
Thank you. kind of creating kind of a movement, and somehow we can all kind of start to take off and then maintain something with the message in the air.
Shocking the old business of Super 8 film
now. We ran out of battery, and this means they got the Super 8 instead of film. We're talking about batteries, energy.
We have to wait.
Something about the kind of work that you do and the research There is something about the intimate relationship with the geology of the earth, which I believe to be an intimate part of the project. And I can connect that with a story, but maybe your story is more interesting.
No, no, but I think so, you know, it's like he's down there, because also Fuller was always talking about it. He was a sailor, right? And when you always go sailing somehow, also you know how long the journey will be. If you cross, usually there's a season also from Europe to America. And you take on board a certain amount of water, a certain amount of food, and you know that the journey will last a week or longer. You get some safety. And isn't this analogy of the time when someone also talks back about a spaceship Earth? I think so we, as human species, we come to a term that the resources somehow not endless, and keep burning fossil fuel, and all the campaign that the garden is doing, keep it on the ground. I think so. It's quite remarkable on the idea of maybe kind of might help us again on this idea of understanding this kind of cosmic relationship about the amount of resources and the way how we are burned now, and how also we learn how to tackle other resources. It might be kind of endless to that extent, this relationship that we can have when we start to understand forces as the sun, the earth, and it can explode. And this has been also when Bucky was trying to draw this project, which was called Cloud Nine. And if you kind of grow in scale, and Fuller was doing it for, I think, a mile diameter long big sphere, you can get also rigid. You can have a geodesic dome very easily. And usually the one that I'm flying so far, when you carry a person up in the air, the degree of temperature between inside and outside is 17 degrees.
What do you mean?
Well, let's say outside is always a difference. Yeah, because you also talk about in the text this differential.
I thought it could be very much lower. Does it have to be that?
Well, it could be much more lower, but it could be much more volume.
Yeah.
Does it mean when you think about something which is a mile diameter, you have a rigid structure? I mean, how much the difference between the inside and the outside we need to this space we can have about it. I mean, you can go down to 1 degree of half degree. I mean, you know, the surface in relation to the volume is to a cubic. I mean, as big as you grow, the volume is getting bigger, the surface is kind of getting less and less relevant. I mean, as big as it is, less difference of temperature between the inside and the outside. It is something quite possible. I mean, now we are talking with people who build the domes or the mining companies, which the biggest is 300 meter diameter, half. We're asking them to make them full. And I tell you, in this sense, you don't need the battery, earth, you don't need the sun, you just need some people breathing. Just the breathing inside space, it might become this piece of air bubble. And this is another energy, but it will also get energy. This is all sort of flow of energy.
So architects have spent 2,000-3,000 years trying to manage gravity when the real problem is how to manage lift and buoyancy.
This is what people should say when we talk about aerodynamic and aerostatic that we have been last time. No, but it's kind of depressing, the aerostatic. So it doesn't give you too much of the idea. No? Of the idea, instead of flying, we are talking always about floating. It's, you know what I mean? It's something about the Archimedes principle. It's kind of like how much this place from our medium to became buoyant. And then you tackle it to the jet streams and then you move when you learn how to manage these things.
I'd like to make one point before we turn it off to the audience, and that is that among the many arguments, you can all say game-changing arguments that people apply to that when you talk about aerostatics, you don't like it, but what it is really, there's nothing static about aerostatics, obviously, because there is a differential, there's a gradient in the environment that is being actively managed. Otherwise, because what you have is a form that is far from equilibrium, and in order to maintain it away, the equilibrium would be flat on Earth, like falling down to the ground. Is this idea, is that space and environment is essentially is driven by biological processes. And this is a fundamental, and it's essentially true, more or less. projects in the work, that the physics of thermodynamics is really physics of life. Okay, so we turn it over to you. Any questions?
Yes. I made a lecture to get a free magazine. You don't have to do
many. Yeah.
Best price to six. Best price. Any question?
Okay.
Oh, we got some.
I have a very simple question. I saw the project you made only with sun. What happens when there is a rain or a thunderstorm? What will happen with your balloons?
No, there are different types of... And I always think, why the hell have to be called balloons? Can we not call them something else? Can we not at the moment I thought, like, well, let's invent a heat pump.
I call them ladders, and that's much worse than what it is.
But, yeah, I have a problem also. but I thought, you know, so far I came up with a heat pump for a period of time, or a geological period, which may might exist, and maybe better to shape this new sensitivity. But so far, according to IOC, then I took the name after the diameter. This one I was in third, the other in front of me. I have some like of certain imagination. But during the day, let's say the one which is half silver and half transparent, they usually fly above the weather. This means they're always above the clouds. And what is a bit of a struggle sometimes is more like kind of a geopolitical clearance of airspace, which will maybe stop the flight. Why would it not have them for over 3 years flying around the Earth? Because when they drop down below 18 kilometers high, they start to interfere with a fossil fuel, dirty dependency on the way how we fly today, which is just keep burning. Now, when I'm making this petition, it's saying that this is like 38, 18 kilometers during the night. Come down, pick up the infrared radiation, go through the clouds, sometimes very cloudy, or sometimes we pass through a surface of an area which has no great albedo, similar reflectivity. This means usually this sculpture which has a flow in the white side, it flows a lot because, you know, when you go to ski and the sun burns you, a lot of reflection. This helps a lot also to relief because you get much more energy somehow. So when the sculpture, let's say, we drop down 18 kilometers, then you have a cut down mechanism, you have to interrupt it. And we stop flying because it starts to get to the airplanes. And this means if we change the law of the air for a couple of demonstrators of different type of mobility, we might be able also to keep it up. Because the lowest altitude is typically through this thermodynamic sample is 10 kilometers. And then we pick up even, you know, when you fly above a very bad weather or over the oceans or parts which are not very good reflective to the piece. See, there are all different types of speculation. You know, when you fly also with reused plastic bags, you know, that means when you come a cloud in front, you come down. But the temperature doesn't drop so radically. It's kind of a smooth landing. It's nothing about burning rockets and immediate reaction. It's much more slow. Even the side cover quite quickly. And the way of launching or getting up into the air is very gentle. It takes you always a little bit of time. It's kind of a much more smooth the transition. Discover even more than us first. If the age of the Anthropos, remember, the Anthropos is always human based. I think so the new age of Aerosene is always kind of interspecies specific or a bit more general, so I'm trying to understand this interconnectedness among not only humans. somehow.
Collaborate and get some grants. It's kind of new also, but
so far have been mostly into the realm of art. And this is a lot of maintaining this dialogue in reality of Varela and Maturana we've been talking before within the context of art, which, you know, I'm all can say that when I'm in the context of art because I don't know what art is, and because art also all the time allows to self-discover to that extent, you know, it's something which is not granted, and this means I can't say art, well, it's all you know. I mean, I know certain parameters I have maybe how to navigate certain things which I also, it would be beautiful also that architect maybe could find a way that, I'm always thinking like very simple, when I finish to study, I say, well, you know, besides, you know, being maybe much more free conversation with artists when I was establishing them, I was with this school of architecture also, but the artist said, maybe hang out longer and bring it more. But one thing which, you know, it's very hard to get at the end. I mean, you finish the study, what do you go to an architectural office, right? And it's very hard to get a residency. When you ask about how many residencies of artists are around the world, I cannot count them everywhere. And it's, I mean, I just was hanging out one resident after the other one, which I think so is sustained kind of the development of something for a wide period of time in society, how self-organized and self on a kind of delayed state of perception of something. As a logo, I have said, is something which, you know, I think so in architecture which should be much more implemented. This means I don't know which other kind of idea might be there, but I think so, yeah.
First of all, what does a box of spiders cost? This series, the Sliver series, was dedicated to a kind of a reflection on art and architecture. In some ways, we could see them as being antagonistic in terms of those who like to preserve the distinction between disciplines. Others see the distinction itself to be no longer meaningful at all. Others look for all kinds of beautiful dissymmetries in which certain aspects and practices from one are starting to, you know, pour over and mix in with others. We don't, let me say this, in the world where you exist, where you are an animal of a kind of new species, where the human brain, the human nervous system is repurposed and reorganized in a sense the way it was during the hunter-gatherer times was essentially to perceive the differences, functional differences in the environment, to sense movement, to sense differentials. And of course this become extremely refined once you have the advantage of the history of concepts and also technological instruments that have been deployed, but in the end, it's still the same nervous system, and it's the same flows, and the same universe, if you like, of nature. It's a lesson for the architect to give up their foolish adherence to boundaries. It's a call to address the problems as they present themselves to us today, which is a hard thing to grasp. And your work, what I find so beautiful about it, one question they always ask, if you were to get up here and say, they say, well, man, what does the air see look like? Well, you showed us, what you do, you show us again and again. That is the thing that I find so fantastic. Nobody can ask that question. Beautiful. Thank you. All right, you're good.